The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
The Jewish people complained about Jesus because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." So they said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph? Do we not know his father and his mother? Then how can he say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Stop complaining among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draw him. And I will raise you up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'They shall all be taught by God.' Everyone who listens to my Father and learns from him comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. I am telling you the truth. Whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the desert, but they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Disciples and handed on to us through the tradition of the church. And for for generations, theologians, as well as simple followers of Jesus, have tried to understand what his words mean. I'm afraid that if you're thinking this morning I can explain it all to you, you will be very disappointed. Because every time I hear these words, I find myself pondering, what exactly do they mean? The people who first heard these words were the Jewish people, and we are told in today's gospel, they actually complained. They complained because that's what we as human beings do. Left to ourselves, we easily fall into the trap of being complaining people. And so they complained because they said to Jesus, is this not Jesus, the carpenter from Nazareth? We know his family. We know his father was Joseph of Nazareth, and so on and so forth. What is he getting off saying he is the bread, the living bread that comes down from heaven? What is he talking about? Again, I am reminded of that proverb that familiarity breeds contempt. You see, Jesus is uttering a great mystery, a great truth, and the ones who are listening to him cannot comprehend his words. It is because our vision falls short of the reality. We are often tempted to think that that which exists can be perceived by our five senses. And if we cannot perceive it through our five senses, then obviously that which we would say exists doesn't exist at all. That we can only believe what we see. And yet the message of the gospel reverberates throughout time, saying to us that everything is not as it appears. We encounter many great mysteries in life that we cannot fully explain. However, we often think that we are able to do so. And I think that this is a mistake and very misleading for us. In fact, people who observe the universe and consider the various mysteries of the universe, and in particular, the mystery of human consciousness, and it is a mystery, we are not able to explain that I have a sense of my own self, and I have a sense of self-consciousness and awareness, and I'm also aware that I am also functioning in a universe in which I can perceive certain realities. But I can't explain my consciousness. How is it that I am able to be an observer in this world? How is it that I can say that I am? This is one of the great perplexing problems. And human thinkers and philosophers have often come with several suggestions. And one of the most common suggestions in our own day, one of those common beliefs about where consciousness comes from, and you've heard it before, is the belief that consciousness arises within the universe from the things of the universe. That out of the material of the universe, that is somehow the atoms and the molecules that form our brains, from this arises consciousness. Now, this idea, which is propagated by many, is called the view of the materialist. The view of the materialist is a view that has no necessity for a belief in a God outside of the universe. They believe that the universe itself can be explained by what we see within the universe, and that we need not resort to anything outside of the universe. And so, quite frankly, human consciousness is something that arises out of the intermixture of chemicals and electrons and all kinds of things that occur in our brains. And yet, the reality is, we can't explain how that is even possible. And in fact, a careful look at the universe tells us that we cannot find an explanation for the existence of the universe within the universe itself. And even now, many physicists are positing that there is actually something outside of the universe. They call it the multiverse. Have you heard this? Do you watch the Science Channel? And so essentially what these physicists, these scientists are saying is that the explanation for the existence of the universe cannot be found within the observable universe itself, and so we need to find an explanation outside of the universe, outside of nature as we know it. And you know what that is called? It's called supernaturalism. And so they're not far from the religious person when they say this kind of thing. The religious person will say that the mystery of consciousness is not something that arises out of inanimate matter, but rather the mystery of consciousness is what is behind everything. That the material universe actually arises from some kind of intentionality, some kind of intelligence behind it all. And we observe the order and the patterns of the universe. We observe the genetic code, which seems to be like a program beyond all imagination, which determines the progress and the development of human life in this world. And so the universe itself is a manifestation of consciousness. Consciousness is the cause of all of creation. There are some scientists that are now saying this very thing, not realizing, many of them, that this is something that we as Christians have been saying all along. And that higher consciousness that is behind the universe, that has caused all things to come into being, is what we call by the word God. God is not a personal name. God is a designation referring to that ultimate reality that is somehow perceived intuitively within the human heart, that is behind all creation and behind even my own ability to be a conscious being. And this God, this being that's beyond all human comprehension, somehow is deeply personal and interested in the universe, and interested in each of us, because we reflect the image of God, because over a period of countless eons, we have come into existence, humanity, which reflects the image of God in that we are personal creatures that possess consciousness. Now, I'm sounding very abstract this morning, and I hope I'm not getting too philosophical at this point, but I want to lay a groundwork for you in this way, as we try to contemplate the mystery of the person of Jesus and the extraordinary claims he makes upon our lives, even into this very hour. For you see, in the Christian narrative, this intelligence, this ultimate intentionality, this consciousness from which the universe emerges, actually comes and visits the human race. The creator enters into his creation. The artist enters into his work of art. And this consciousness, this ultimate being we call God, actually became, in a historical place and time, one of us. Theologians call this the miracle of the incarnation. The creator, God, the ultimate consciousness, now clothes himself in human flesh and walks among us as one of us. And he was recognized as being one of us. They said, is he not Joseph's son? Is he not the carpenter from Nazareth? The person of Jesus of Nazareth, who lived at a particular time in a particular place and was a particular human person, was simultaneously at the same time the divine consciousness revealed to the world. And he has come to reveal the intentionality of our Creator. He has come from God in order to reveal God to us. He is Emmanuel. He is God with us. And Christianity is built upon this foundation of the person of Jesus. Jesus is not some great philosopher. In fact, he gave us no philosophy. Jesus was not some sort of idealist or great moral teacher, even though we will find interesting things he has to say about human relationships. Jesus is a divine person who was fully human, living among us, that we may be brought back into the presence and reconnected to that ultimate consciousness that somehow we've lost along the way. It is this Jesus who is the embodiment of the divine life, who says to you and me today, I am the bread of life. You see, Christianity is not just another religion to lay aside other religions. Christianity is something else. Christianity is all about a person, a single person. It's all about Jesus of Nazareth. You cannot have Christianity without Jesus Christ. It is impossible. Christianity has always been about him. Although throughout the centuries there have been religious leaders, church authority that would like to make something out of Christianity that it is not. You know it's Christianity when it is focused upon the person of Jesus. We must not put our faith in our institutions or anything that we have created and say that that is the thing itself. Nothing can displace the fact that Jesus is the absolute radical center of our faith. And if we are connected to Jesus, then we know that we are practicing some kind of authentic Christianity. And Jesus has come to give his life for the world, his flesh for the life of the world. That is for you and me. Jesus reveals to us that we cannot have any spiritual life, let alone eternal life, unless somehow we receive his life. It is in receiving his life that we receive eternal life, and we are now at union with God. I have the bulletin here today, which I seldom hold, and I rarely read. Even though I tell you to read the bulletin. But I wrote something here. It's actually part of my homily. I want you to turn to the bulletin, and you see in here, I wrote a little blurb about Christianity. You see it? I want everyone to have a bulletin, but I want you to take this home. It is vital that we get this. You have it. Look carefully. Put on your glasses. Christianity is all about Jesus. Christianity is all about Jesus. It always has been about this Jewish man from first century Galilee. He is not only the messenger, he is the message. He not only proclaims the gospel, he is the embodiment of the gospel. Jesus is the one and only Word of God that became flesh and dwelt among us in a particular place and at a particular time in human history. He not only reveals the divine to us, he is in his very person divine. He is the Son of Man, the Messiah, and he is the Son of God, the Savior of the whole world. Jesus is not only a prophet, he is the prophet, the culmination of all the prophets who has come into the world. Jesus is the eternal divine word through which the universe came into being and is constantly sustained. Jesus is the Redeemer who redeems all of creation. Jesus is the one who gives us the living water of the Holy Spirit, who satisfies our deepest thirst for eternal life. Jesus is the light of the world who overcomes the dark power of the evil one and death. Jesus not only feeds the world with the food of eternal life, he is the bread of life. Jesus is the good shepherd who leads us into the place of peace and contentment. Jesus not only raises the dead, He is, in his very person, the resurrection and the life. He is the gate to heaven, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of all the world, the Lord of love, and the rightful ruler of every human heart. Jesus is Emmanuel, God in our midst. Now catch this, my brothers and sisters. Our only responsibility as his disciples is to remain in loving union with him so that his life becomes our life. To remain in loving union with him means that we must surrender ourselves to him that he may present us to his God and Father in order that divinity may be all in all. So, you see, it is all about Jesus, and it always was. This is who, and I say who deliberately, authentic Christianity is all about. It's all about the person of Jesus. Now, my brothers and sisters, I hope that is useful to you to take it home and meditate upon that with that reflection. But I want to sum up what this means for us. Jesus said, apart from me, speaking to his disciples, you can do nothing apart from me. And he calls us into relationship with him, the divine person of the Son, in relationship with each and every human person, with all of humanity. When we speak of God in the abstract, and then we say you must love God, it is impossible. It is impossible to love an abstract idea about consciousness behind the universe. That seems so impersonal. God knows that, because we are beings that are social and are in need of relationship. If you remove me from the world of others, I lose my humanity. I lose my sense of being a person. The fact that I'm a person is dependent upon my relationship with other persons. This is at the heart of the matter. We can only become fully a human person when we are in relationship with the divine person who called all things into being. But how can I love God who seems so enormous and incomprehensible? Through the person of Jesus, God becomes one of us. I can love Jesus. I can relate to his person because he's also fully human like me. I can call out to him, and he responds, and I have a relationship with him. We are called not to tell just another story that someone else told us. We are called, as disciples of Jesus, to bear witness to Christ. How can I bear witness to anything unless I've experienced that reality? I can only bear witness to Jesus insofar that I have experienced within my heart a living relationship with the risen Christ. Then I am fully alive. And then as I witness and I go out from this place and I bear witness, I do so not handing people Bible tracts and trying to convince everybody to agree with my opinions about life. That's not what Jesus means about bearing witness. When I have a living relationship with Christ, it transforms me. His life becomes a part of my life. His life is hidden in my heart. And this dramatically transforms me so that when I interact with other persons in the world, my actions are informed by love, a love that is transformative. St. Francis says, preach the gospel at all times, and only when necessary use words. And so I am proclaiming Christ every time I help my wife or help my son or my children, or if I engage with people in the world, when I do loving actions, I'm bearing witness to the reality of Christ living within me. Why? Because I'm continuing the work of Christ. And what is the work of Christ? To bring redemption into the world. And what does redemption of the world look like? Whenever we do anything to alleviate human suffering in others, we are continuing the work of Christ's redemptive activity in the world. Redemption is transformation. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we gather in this church around this Eucharistic table, which is the center of our worship. We come and we offer bread and wine. Bread and wine that we offer to God in holy sacrifice. But then something happens. The Holy Spirit comes, and that ordinary bread and wine becomes transformed into the extraordinary presence of Christ. That bread and wine becomes for us the body and blood, the soul and divinity of Jesus. What do we mean when we say that? It is His very life that that manifests itself upon the altar, and then we receive that as the faithful, as disciples, and we take the life of Christ within us. And that is eternal life. This is what we do every Sunday. We come to this table that we may receive the life of Christ through the word that is proclaimed and through the Eucharistic meal that we participate in. That is why it is a shame to send anyone away empty-handed from the Eucharistic table. That is why it's so important that every person be invited to take a place at their table at the invitation of Christ to receive His life. Because as His life becomes manifest in our lives, we participate in the very life of God. And that is a life that is greater than death itself. It is that eternal life that gives us hope. It is that eternal life that enables us to bring transformation to all the world. So, my brothers and sisters, we eagerly come together to this table to receive from Jesus. But we also do something else. We also come to offer something to Jesus. Not just bread and wine, not just the offering collection. Those are signs of what we should be doing. God is interested in you, and He wants you to surrender your life to His Son, Jesus. As we surrender our ego, our narcissism, our self-interest to Jesus, He replaces it with His divine love. And we too become bread from heaven to this world. And that, my brothers and sisters, is the gospel of the Lord. Let us stand together as we profess our faith.